September 11th, 2001. A day of grief. A day of courage. This is how that day unfolded.
My daughter called me. She said, plane just flew into the World Trade Center. I said, nah, you gotta be kidding. It's gotta be a Piper Cub or some clown was flying down the river.
One tower in flames, the tragedy is only beginning. It is 9:03 when United Airlines Flight 175, with 65 aboard, traveling at the speed of 590 miles per hour, smashes into the South Tower of the World Trade Center. At 10:28, the television mast atop the North Tower spears straight down.
Once the collapse started, there really wasn't any way to stop it.
Power is down in Lower Manhattan.
Washington. Of course, in Washington, at this moment, they have grounded 4,500 planes. They're in the process of it. Orders are going out that they are to intercept planes in the air.
To those horrifying moments as American Flight 77 was heading towards the Pentagon.
I didn't hear anything, but I saw the aircraft above my head, about 80 feet above the ground, 400 miles an hour.
I remember thinking the first one was likely an accident, the second one was an attack, and the third plane was a declaration of war. I remember thinking, here I am, the commander-in-chief in a war zone. We'd been attacked by an enemy right here in the heart of our capital.
As the skies over America emptied of planes on September 11, 2001, only one aircraft remained flying, Air Force One. At the controls on that tragic day was Mark Tillman, who thought he was on a routine trip to Florida with President George W. Bush. Tillman's job that day was to fly the president from Sarasota, Florida, back to Washington, D.C. Tillman said that during this flight, it was significant for us and the president to look out the window and see F-16s on his wing. Whatever we needed them to do, they could do, said Tillman. It was a great feeling to see those guys. I still choke up thinking about it. Tillman flew Bush home to Washington, D.C. later that awful day, and a few days later flew him to New York.
We're all praying tonight that authorities are able to thwart any other attack. We're mindful of those whose lives were forever changed by what happened here 10 years ago. I know you have an exclusive interview with one such woman. Brian?
Well, that's right. This is the story of what happened that day in the air. As the hijackers commandeered the planes, it was the people in the country's air traffic control towers who first realized what was really going on.
This Sunday, Danielle Howell will be back at work at the same place she was on September 11th, 10 years ago.
That will be a bit unnerving. It will, I'm sure, raise the hairs on my arm.
Danielle was in the Dulles Airport Control Tower that day outside Washington, one of the FAA air traffic controllers 10 years ago who saw and heard the hijack horror unfold.
The nightmares have faded. They truly have.
At 8:25 that morning, she handled the routine on-time departure of American Flight 77, a Boeing 757 like this one, with 59 people and five hijackers on board. When we talked with her back then, Danielle recalled it as just a normal radio transmission.
American 77 Dulles approach, climb and maintain 17,000. And then I asked American 77 to contact the next controller. American 77, contact Washington Center, 120.65. Good luck.
20 minutes later, as the hijacked planes began their deadly, coordinated missions, it was air traffic controllers around the country who were the first to realize it, starting with a strange transmission from American Flight 11 out of Boston, the voice of hijacker Mohammed Atta.
We have some planes. Just stay quiet and you'll be okay.
Mohammed Atta entered the United States on June the 3rd, 2000. He quickly enrolled in a flight school in Venice, Florida, where he spent 6 months earning his pilot's license.
American Flight 11 hit the North Tower of the World Trade Center seconds later, as controllers realized another flight out of Boston was also hijacked.
I just dropped 800 feet in like one sweep.
That's another situation.
It was United Flight 175 hitting the South Tower.
Another one just hit the building.
Wow.
The whole building just came apart.
Then the drama shifted to Washington as the flight Danielle had handled, American 77, disappeared from radar and then headed back into the Capitol.
Okay, he's 12 miles west. He's moving very fast, eastbound. Okay, guys, where is he now? 11 miles west. And it was just a countdown.
The White House was told to evacuate.
You guys, please, all the way to 8th Street, please.
And it went 6, 5, 4. And I had it in my mouth to say 3. And all of a sudden, the plane turned away. This must be one of our guys sent in, scrambled to patrol our Capitol and to protect our president. And we sat back in our chairs and breathed for just a second, and the plane turned back. He continued the right-hand turn, made a 360-degree maneuver.
A big loop?
Correct. And we're telling the supervisor he's turning back in. He's turning back eastbound.
The controller next to Danielle was Tom Howell.
And the turn kept going. And that's when I think I yelled to John. I said, oh my God, John, he's coming back.
And we waited, and we waited. And your heart's just beating out of your chest.
American 77 then hit its target, the Pentagon.
It looks like that aircraft crashed into the Pentagon, sir.
Badly shaken, Danielle left her job as an air traffic controller, taking a few years off.
Just to kind of get my thoughts back together, to get myself back on an even keel, to be sure that I was ready for duty.
Now she says she is ready for duty. Danielle married the air traffic controller who sat next to her that awful day, Tom Howell.
Having the bond of 9/11 is just an unspoken bond between us.
And together they have a daughter, Tiffany, now 3 years old, and a symbol for Danielle of all they and the country have been through.
Tiffany is a glimmer of hope. So I hope that our nation also finds themselves feeling that way, that there is hope, that there is positive yet to be had in the world. And yes, we do need to remember, because we learn from the past.
For Nightline, I'm Brian Ross, ABC News.
hate my picture taken.
I got donuts.
I used to tell that to Phil all the time, and he'd do it anyways.
I smelled that coffee. It smells good. Yeah, because I have friends who tell me how to make it.
Terry, I can't believe how much you put. How many cups of coffee? Right.
Good, how are you?
I don't know. How many scoops do you put in? Oh, Gail puts in one. What did he tell us, Jane?
I think he said one for eight cups.
So you drink dirty water.
God, I do four scoops for eight cups. How much did you put in?
That's what I do.
No, not this one. I put 2.5 cups.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because
I was going to say, I had a coffee scooper. I like my coffee strong.
Coffee and donuts. Coffee, donuts, and balloons. Vivian, could you get me a donut?
What'd you say?
Would you get me a donut?
Of course. What kind do you like?
I don't, just a plain one.
Here comes your balloon lady. Oh. All right, we're putting balloons on you. Are you on this one?
I'm afraid if I had anything but a plane, it would get all over me.
Hit the North Tower, okay?
Morning.
Are you counting?
No, I'm not counting. Morning. Hey.
Good morning. How are y'all?
Morning. Morning. At the end of this, you're back to the end of it, aren't you?
Yeah. The car.
The car.
Is the last.
How you doing?
Well, good morning, sir. How many?
34.
34.
Well, I got bad news here for this short little clip of people waving their arms and swaying with the music. It's all copyrighted music, and I cannot use it on YouTube. If I put it on there, they would not show the video or permit the YouTube the video to be on YouTube, and that would be the entire video. So in order to protect my standing with YouTube, I have to separate the audio from the video. So just kind of watch them waving their hands and swaying with the music and just sing along to the song. That's all you got to do. Proud to be American. Lee Greenwood. So how about a picture of Lee Greenwood? Would that work? Probably won't be as good as listening to him sing, but it's a nice picture.
Taps are over. you can leave the golf course.
Right here at the end of the movie, my camera froze up. I've still got the audio, but I lost the image of or the video of Jeff East playing taps. But I think I've taken care of that. Sorry that happened.